this talk. So Tyler, we put you at the end of a block of very philosophical talks, and you're gonna bring it back to the grounded world of spreadsheets.
I love it. I don't know if I'd call it grounded. We'll get silly with it, I think. Yeah. It'll be fun.
Yeah, and I do need to read the part of your bio that's my favorite in terms of when not building the Sistine Chapel of spreadsheets, you can be found roaming the English countryside or being really, really bad at Slay the Spire, which it's a beautiful bio.
I've put I think over 300 hours into Slay the Spire since the first lockdown, I think, so back in 2020, and I still can't get past Ascension 3, so...
The point of roguelikes is not to be good at them. Yeah. But yeah, so take it away. Prototyping your game with spreadsheets.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, so I'm Tyler. My pronouns are he, him. I'm also in London, but my accent is distinctly Californian, so I apologize for that in advance. I'm going to share, actually, if that's okay, I'm going to share a link in the chat, and I'm just going to hit send and see if it works. There we go. So that's in the chat in the theater room. And if you're watching on YouTube, we'll make sure that it gets into the description as well. That goes to my slides. I'm talking about spreadsheets. So my slides are spreadsheets. Back in like March 2020, first lockdown in the UK, the worst possible thing happened to me. I became a spreadsheet super user. I didn't want to use spreadsheets for making financial dashboards or, you know, doing my taxes. I wanted to make games with them. And they're not great. I don't think we're going to be seeing any AAA games with spreadsheets anytime soon, but they are really fun for prototyping games and seeing if an idea is going to be any fun before you move to something sensible, like, I don't know, Unity or Unreal Engine or whatever the cool kids are using these days. So I'm going to walk you through kind of the last 2 years of how I've been learning how to make games in spreadsheets and some tips and some like secrets of spreadsheets that you can use in your own games. We'll start with how it started for me, which was the paint bucket tool. You can, in basically any spreadsheet app, use this little paint bucket tool to fill in a cell of any color you like. And if you're like me, you occasionally commit some time theft and do something like, and I'll zoom out for you, make Mario World 1-1. I'm not going to say how long this took me because the next slide is more embarrassing. I spent a little bit more time and committed a little bit more time theft and discovered that I can make a pixel accurate version of Mario 1-1. This is only the first little bit because this is already 90,000 cells. So any more than this would do me in, I think. But you get to around this point and you realize, oh, I want to change something. I want to make it more dynamic. Say I want to make the sky a gray color for like an underground level, but I don't want to do it all by hand. So that brings you to the first kind of secret power of spreadsheets is called conditional formatting. Basically every spreadsheet app has this. You go to format, you go to conditional formatting, and that lets you change the color and the styling of cells based on rules. Things like, is it empty or not? Is there a certain character in it? Is a custom formula, does it resolve to true? And you can do things like this next slide, which will take a second to load, because again, it's 90 some odd thousand cells, where you have different formulas for each color. So it's sort of a color by numbers in a way, where for example, all the sky is actually just a bunch of sixes. And you can see I've typed in a six in all of these cells, which I'm not gonna tell you how long that took. So if I wanted to change the style, and there it's reloading because now I'm messing with stuff. If I wanted to change the color of the sky, I could do that just here in this rule, and it's going to go ahead and change all that automatically for me. And I'm going to back away from that to give it some time to load, because it does take a while. If it's just the only thing in a sheet, it's pretty quick, but because we have some exciting stuff later on, some of these things take a little bit longer to load. Let's go back and see if it... There we go. Yeah. So now the sky is gray. If you want to play along at home and you want to edit this for yourself, say you're watching the video right now, you can go to File and make a copy, and that copy is going to be all yours. Feel free to mess around with it all you want. So now we've got conditional formatting. Let's go ahead and look at making things interactive. There are some options for making things interactive, things like if you're an Excel user, Visual Basic is a very common one, or you have Google Apps Script for Google Sheets, but I like to stick to just stuff that's in the spreadsheet itself. And in this case, that's a checkbox. checkboxes you can get to from the insert menu. Checkboxes are really cool because it's just a button that goes right in the spreadsheet. And when it's checked, it resolves to true. And when it's unchecked, it resolves to false. And so you can do things like this formula here that says, if the checkbox is true, increment my number by one. Otherwise, leave me as is. So you can start to build things that, you know, numbers that go up or down based on whether a checkbox is checked. Unfortunately, and you've probably already noticed, by default, this gives you an error. And this is the second sort of secret of spreadsheets, is iterative calculation. By default, spreadsheets aren't self-aware. I think Google Sheets is really trying to avoid a Skynet situation. They don't know what value they have inside themselves until you go to File, Settings, Calculation, Iterative Calculation, and you turn that on. And I'm actually going to turn the maximum number of iterations to one as well. What this does is it lets a cell, or all cells rather, see what's already in the cell and calculate based on that. So now we have a cell that starts at zero, and every time I check the checkbox, the number goes up by one. And I uncheck, nothing happens, I check, it goes up by one. And so you can start building on this and making something like a tiny Nintendo Switch, where each button corresponds with a number, and every time I check a box, the number goes up by one. Except, whoops, if I leave the box checked and I check another box, the first box still goes up by one. So now we need to figure out how we can determine what the most recent checkbox to be clicked was. And to do that, here's the third little secret of spreadsheets. We need to understand how they process data. And this took about a year for me to understand. So don't feel bad if you don't get it right away. Please play around in this spreadsheet if you're interested. Spreadsheets read information from left to right and top to bottom. So anytime I change something in this sheet, it starts with A1, calculates that, goes to B1, calculates that, and goes all the way to Z1, and then goes to the second row and does the same thing all the way over and over and over. So instead of having just a checkbox, we can have helper formulas that calculate one before the other. In this case, the leftmost formula is going to calculate before the rightmost formula. So if we have the rightmost formula say, hey, if the checkbox is changed, make me match the checkbox, and the leftmost formula say, set yourself to true if the rightmost formula and the checkbox don't match, we can calculate which of the checkboxes I clicked most recently. And here's that in action. I've added some conditional formatting to help visualize this. If I click the first one, we get true there. I click the second one, and we get true over here. If I keep clicking the second one, we keep getting true over there. If I keep clicking the first one, we get true over there. So now we can go back to our first example, and instead of the numbers, we have these helper formulas for each checkbox that say, here was the last thing checked. Okay, I can breathe now. I apologize to our sonographer, and thank you for getting through that. So now we have a little game space where we can track what the most recent button to be pressed was. And while it's not maybe great for a game like Mario, because it only updates when I click something, it's pretty great for things like a roguelike game. And we can do things like this, where we add numbers along the top and left of our screen and add formulas inside the screen to say, hey, if an X and Y value, which go up or down based on whatever button I press, if they match where I'm at on the screen, display a little at symbol. So you can now move this little character around your little screen. And that's the basis of things like Rogue or NetHack the system we're using today for Roguelike Celebration. And you can add as much as you want to this. So in the next sheet we have, I've added a map, which is just text. Here, I can open this up. Text where I tried to write RC, you can kind of see it. The spot where the places where the character can move are dots, and the places where the character can't move are pound signs. And the screen now takes a regex formula just built into the spreadsheet to either display the at symbol, if that's where the player is, or the corresponding character from the map. And then we have some extra formulas over here to determine whether the character can move into the spot I want them to move into. So now you can have the little at symbol there moving around. And if I try to move them through a wall, nothing's happening. And you can also do things like add formulas to the numbers that we added to the top and left of the screen to create some sort of a camera effect. So if I go past the middle of the screen here, see the numbers go up, moving what you see in the map and staying with the character. So I can actually move the character through the map here and get to the other side. There we go. And now once you've got all that, you might want to make it look nicer. You can do things like this, where we've added some emojis. What I've done here is I've added a range of emojis that now our screen is doing a VLOOKUP formula to say, hey, I was going to put an at symbol here, but let me look up in this range what I should put instead. And that lets us do some really cool things. Like I said, you could drop images in here, or you could have formulas that change what emoji is placed. Let's see, I can click on this and I can say I want... let's still do a tree, but let's say, oh, my partner would hate me for this because we're not past Halloween yet, but let's say let's do Christmas trees. So now we have a wizard in Christmas, and that's, all the same stuff. I've also done, I've colored in the numbers here. So the numbers are still there. They just match the background color, and I've colored in the buttons as well to make everything a little bit prettier. And, if you want, you can also kind of get rid of the whole, Or rather, you can add some stuff to this. I was getting ahead of myself there. You can add things like a goal. Say you have a treasure that has an X and Y value. You can then check whether the player's X and Y value matches the treasure's X and Y value and do something else. And to me, the first thing that I think of when I think of that, I think of snake as sort of the prime example. So here we have a working snake. Where you can move the snake, and if the head of the snake matches the apple's X and Y value, the length of the snake goes up by one. And there it goes. Now their snake's getting a little longer. I could play this for hours, but I won't. If you wanted, and this is where I was going earlier, you could also get rid of the buttons on the side, and you could make the screen itself buttons. And you'd end up with something like this, a game of checkers, where instead of having stuff off to the side here, each of these little cells is itself a checkbox that you can click on. And when you click on a piece, you can click another piece to move it. And I've made a very legal and very, very rules heavy game of checkers, you can tell, and a little reset button there for you. And you could do lots of things with this. You could do a turn-based strategy game, you could do chess, you could do even just another roguelike game without the up, down, left, right buttons. And you could get rid of the squares altogether if you want. You could, for example, make a text adventure. Whoops, and let me restart the text adventure here. I've hidden it all, but in the back end, this is all basically the same thing. We're looking at the player's X and Y value, but instead of showing graphics, we're showing text. And you can do things like, say, go south, click the little button, and you go south, and then it displays the text in whatever room to the south of you is. And you could add graphics, like I said, you could add pictures, or we have built-in functions like Sparkline. Sparkline is really cool. You have bar charts, you have line graphs for like taxes, or you can give it a whole bunch of numbers to do things like Bezier curves and, you know, draw faces and draw little animations if you want even. And that brings us to the last thing. This is the thing I'm kind of like still working on. So if this is interesting to you, get in touch with me. You can, with a lot of numbers and a lot of math, do 3D objects and 3D worlds all using built-in spreadsheet formulas and built-in spreadsheet features. So there we have a Triforce that I'm moving around, and off in the distance we have another little Triforce that you can walk up to. All right, I hope some of that was interesting. I'm going to go back to my first slide here. If any of that was interesting, A. Tyler Robertson is where I'm at on basically every social platform, so please come chat. I'm always happy to talk about it. And thanks again.
Tyler. It's so early in the conference. You can't do this to us.
See, it's late in the day for me, so I've had like a few coffees. This is great.
I've learned that if we start with the Europeans, the North Americans will be destroyed mentally. Oh my god. Okay. I don't know how to follow that up.
I'm glad, I guess.
Oh man. I guess the one question I have that I'm curious, which, it's fun, because, like, in terms of the title, prototyping your game with spreadsheets, I am curious, after you've gotten a hang of it, how long does it take you to make some of these things? Like, I assume, like, the first time, like, figuring out how to do that, that's time-consuming. Once you've got the hang of it, what does it take?
Oh gosh. So it kind of depends. There's a lot of stuff now, like so everything that you see in that presentation and in that spreadsheet, I made over the course of about a week. A lot of it is stuff that I've made before, which really helps. So there's some stuff in there, like, I mean, even the basic buttons. So finding out how to do the more advanced buttons took a year. Because nobody's doing this. I think because it's a bad
No, they're
idea.
not, Tyler.
It's I think because it I think because you shouldn't do it, I think is the honest answer. So there's just no one writing about it, and I was like, I know this can happen, I know this can exist. So that took about a year, but once I got that up and running, it made things a lot easier. So like in my portfolio on my website, I have a turn-based strategy game that took about a month. But that also has cells with 200 nested if functions. So it was sort of a bad month for me.
But a good month for the rest of us. Thank you. I feel very privileged that we got to learn from your years of experimenting with things you should never, ever, ever probably do in Google Sheets.
Thank you. No, that's so kind. I'm so glad to be here.
No, and listen, everybody enjoyed it. Chat was collectively losing their minds, and I think that people are, yes, having a great time. This
Good. Oh, I'm
was,
glad.
yes, very fun. Oh, all right. So your room will be cleric if people want
Cleric.
to talk more about things you shouldn't do in spreadsheets. I can't believe you did 3D vector
It's slow.
graphics.
I had a lot more and it slowed down the whole spreadsheet. So there's more to be had for sure.
I can't handle more. So so thank you very much, Tyler. No, that was wonderful.
Yeah, thank you. And I'll talk to everybody in Cleric.
Yes. All right. People can see you there. Thank you.